Morning. Sure is good to see all of y'all. The sound of the singing was pretty awesome, so I'm assuming we have quite a few extra in the auditorium, which is great. It's always an encouragement. This morning we're going to spend some time encouraging our seniors and preparing them to go about their life and do the things that they're going to do, whatever life is going to bring their way. And so we're going to spend some time in the book of Hebrews talking about faith. But before that, we're going to send them off with a really cheesy joke, you know, because that's how we do it around here. So I want you to think about this. So one Sunday, this young boy was in this Bible class, and the teacher started talking about Adam and Eve and telling the story about how God allowed Adam to go into a deep sleep and from his side pulled a rib and created Eve. And so this one particular little boy, he was very intrigued by this story. He thought, I don't know how to think about that. So he struggled with it all day long, thought about it. Later that day, he was at home running around with his brothers and sisters, and he started getting tired, and his side started to hurt, and then his stomach started to hurt. And so he went inside, and he laid down on the couch, and he was starting to look really flushed. So his mom comes in and says, are you feeling okay? And he says, no, I'm not. I'm feeling terrible. My side hurts. I think I'm going to have a wife. I'm glad you laughed at that. All right, so we're going to spend some time in the book of Hebrews. It doesn't work that way, just in case you were wondering. As you go out into the world, that's not how it's going to work, finding a spouse. But we are going to be talking about some things that do work, and that is this idea of faith. And having a proper understanding of faith is so incredibly important for you as you go into the world. You need to understand what the Bible says about faith. So Hebrews chapter 11 is where we're going to be. So if you want to follow along, this is half chapter 11, verse 1. It says, now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. For by it the men of old gained approval. Now, I like the New King James Version, or I really like reading a bunch of different versions just to kind of get an idea of how different interpretations go. But the New King James is particularly interesting to me. He says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. I think our problem with the word faith is it gets thrown around a lot in society. A lot in the world, but a lot on TV. A lot of times you'll hear even, you know, on a news broadcast where people will use that word faith, and they just really use it in a different context than what the Bible uses the word faith for. And so you might think about it this way. A person might easily say, you know, I have faith that I'm going to get that job I applied for. That's one way that somebody would use that word faith in the world. Or you might say, I have faith that food in that Tupperware container that's not labeled that I found at the very back of the refrigerator is still good, and I can eat it. You know, that's a lot of faith, right, in that little Tupperware container. But really, those ideas are not biblical faith. That's not faith. That is really wishful thinking. You know, I'm really hoping, but I'm not sure. You know, I don't really have any substance to this. I don't really know, but I'm kind of hoping, wishful. But when you're talking about biblical faith, that's not biblical faith. Biblical faith is not hoping in the sense that I'm not sure. Biblical faith is not wishing in the sense that I don't really know, but I'm kind of leaning towards that direction. You know, it's kind of like the Tupperware container. I really hope when I eat this thing, I'm not going to get food poisoning or something, you know, because I don't know how long it's been in there, but I've got faith. It's not how the Bible presents it. That's not the kind of faith that the Christian has, and that's not the faith that we need to have. Let's look at a couple examples. This is the Hebrew writer talking about some people who lived by faith, and by faith they were approved of God, that God approved of them. They made a change. They made a difference in the world, and their families and society, because they live by faith. So the first one is here. It says, by faith, we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things which are visible. And so we begin with this idea of faith in the sense of things that are not seen. You know, we weren't there. I wasn't there when the world was created. I'm not that old. I don't know exactly how all that would have looked or felt or sounded. I don't really know. But I know by faith that God created the world with His Word. I know because the Word of God tells me that He did. That's one way that I have faith about it. But another way I have faith is I look around and I say, wow, I mean, this world's incredible. The way it functions, the way it's organized, I mean, the design of it is incredible. And so I have these two things that are very sure. One of them being the Word of God that says that God spoke these things into existence, and another being the actual substance in which I can see. And those things combined, I can have faith. And so what we would say is, how powerful is God's Word? Well, it's so powerful that He can speak something into existence. That's how powerful the Word of God is. That's how powerful His Word is, right? I mean, we don't have that kind of power. I can't speak something into existence. Well, I can order takeout, you know, that's kind of the same thing, I guess. But in reality, I can't just say, you know, let there be a chair here and there be a chair here, because that wouldn't work. I can't do that, but God can. That'd be kind of trivial for God. I mean, you know, after all, He did speak all of the universe into creation. But the idea is that His Word is powerful. His promises are powerful. Look at verse 6. And He says, and without faith it is impossible to please Him, for he who comes to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of those who seek Him. God is a rewarder of those who seek Him. So there are two aspects of faith that are necessary for anyone to be able to come to God. Two aspects of faith. He must believe that God exists. He must believe that God exists. When we go out into the world, especially when you're young and you get into a college environment, there will certainly be people who don't believe that God exists. Now, I say that because there'll be people who do believe, and those people are going to be great assets for us and for you in the world, but there will certainly be people who will say, God doesn't exist. And our faith will be challenged, your faith will be challenged when you encounter people who want to convince you God doesn't exist. But the Hebrew writer is saying that God is a rewarder of those who seek Him. That all of creation speaks to the power of His Word that created all things. That's the kind of faith that we have. Another is, he must believe that God rewards those who earnestly seek Him. We have to believe that. And we have to seek God. So here's our first person, verse 7. By faith, Noah, being warned by God about things not seen, in reverence prepared an ark for the salvation of his household, by which he condemned the world and became the heir of righteousness, which is according to faith. According to faith. Now, you might know the story. You're probably familiar the story with Noah, how God warns Noah that there's a judgment coming, and he says, you know, this is what you need to do. You need to build this ark. He gives them the dimensions, the blueprints of the ark. Noah begins building this ark. But how do you think Noah's neighbors thought of him, right? I mean, if you were Noah's neighbor and you looked over there and saw this dude building an ark in his backyard, what would you think? That guy's crazy, right? I mean, that Noah dude. I mean, I'm sure people, when they drove by his house, locked their doors, right? Or whatever they, you know, did back then that is equivalent to that. But the idea is that, you know, they must have thought he was nuts, right? I mean, here's this guy, he's claiming to hear voices, right? And not only is he claiming to hear voices, now he's building a boat in his backyard. I mean, they must have thought he was just completely off his rocker. But Noah, because of the Word of God, because he knew that those words were God's words, he didn't have to see the flood. He didn't have to see anything. He just had to listen to God, believe God, trust God, and act upon that. That's faith. You know, it wasn't a wishful thinking. It wasn't hypothetical. Noah didn't say, well, I don't know, but let's just be safe. You know, it's better safe than sorry. That wasn't Noah. There's no indication that Noah doubted for a moment. He went to great lengths, great expense, great effort, great ridicule to ensure that his family was saved, despite the fact of the persecution and the ridicule. So here's an idea. And these are the three things I want you to remember. He heard God. He trusted God. He obeyed God. He heard God, he trusted God, and he obeyed God. And as a result, his family was saved. Now, it's interesting to think about because we will encounter in our life, and we do from time to time, and especially if you're graduating and you're heading off to college, you will encounter people that think you're crazy for being a Christian. You know, it's just foolish. It's barbaric. It's not the way things are. That there was certainly, I've experienced it. We've all experienced it. Times where people will think that you're crazy for believing in God, crazy for believing in Jesus, just crazy for the whole thing, just like they thought about Noah. But what we need is to make sure that we read the Word of God. That's how we hear the Word of God. And we hear it, and we trust it, and we obey it, regardless of what anybody else says, right? Regardless of what may happen. Here's another one. This is Abraham. He says, by faith, Abraham, when he was called, obeyed by going out to a place which he received for an inheritance, and he went out not knowing where he was going. And it's real simple. God called him, and he went. You know, doesn't seem like there was a whole lot of persuasion or prodding going on. We don't really know the details of all of that, but it seems like Abraham had faith. He knew those words were God's words. That's important, knowing God's word. And then he responded to that word. And when God said for him to leave his country, he left because there were things that God had prepared for him. And it's hard to imagine ever doing that. It's hard to imagine just uprooting and leaving a place, based on somebody else's word. But when that word is God's word, we can imagine that's faith. He heard the word and he responded to it. God called and he went. Look at verse 9. He said, by faith he lived as an alien in the land of promise, as in a foreign land, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, fellow heirs of the same promise, for he was looking for a city which has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. Now Abraham knew, he knew that all this journey that he was on, that the best part of the inheritance, the best part of the promise to come, that was something that was coming in the future, that he looked ahead, you know, at something that he wouldn't even really see, that he wouldn't really experience, and he knew that God had this grand purpose and this grand plan in the future, and he was a part of it, most certainly. And he responded to that promise, he responded to that hope, he responded to the future reality in the present. And that's how he lived his life. And that's how we live our life too, isn't it? We have this future hope, this future expectation, we have this future promise that God has given us through Jesus, and we live the life right now with hope because God said so. Because God's promises are true, because God's words are powerful, and we live by faith, despite what people might say, and despite what we might see, and despite all of it, because we know that God is faithful to his promises, and we are living this life with that hopeful expectation constantly in our view. He looked forward to a city with foundations whose architect and builder was God. That was his story. That's really our story, too, as we live by faith. Look at verse 11. He says, by faith, even Sarah herself received the ability to conceive even beyond proper time of life, since she considered him faithful who had promised. Now, I love the way the New Testament often repeats these stories, because if you've read the story, you know that a lot of that was, well, it's kind of messy. It's kind of messy. They couldn't have a son at first, and they went to great lengths to try to make God's promises become a reality. Sarah even laughed when she heard the news that she in her old age was going to have a son. In fact, that's in essence the name Isaac means laughter. But nonetheless, the Hebrew writer kind of puts all of that, you know, as a part of the story. Yes, but he just displays their faith. He just says, Sarah was faithful. And somebody might say, yeah, but she had her doubts and she may have laughed. I don't really know. It wasn't her. I wasn't there. But it seems like there were some times when those words, those promises were difficult to understand and to swallow, to comprehend, to believe. But the Hebrew writer pushes all of that aside, all the messiness, all the efforts to bring about the promise by some other means. And the Hebrew writer just simply says that Sarah considered him faithful who had promised. You know, our faith rests on the faithfulness of God. Our faith rests on the faithfulness of God. God is faithful. If you believe that, God is faithful, then your faith will be strong because whatever God says, we know He will do and can do. And that's where our faith has foundation. That's where our faith takes root and begins to produce in us the life that God wants for us. Verse 12, he says, therefore, there was born even of one man, and him as good as dead at that. You know, he doesn't really go easy on that. As many descendants as the stars of heaven in number, and innumerable as the sand which is by the seashore. God was faithful to his promise. See, these stories stand as a testament to God to say, look what God has done. Look what he did. He made this promise. He fulfilled the promise in an incredible way, seemingly impossible circumstances. He brought about the reality that he promised. And so when we look at ourselves and we look to the promises that we have in Jesus, we can look back at these stories and we say, you know what? God has always been faithful. God has always kept his word. God has always done what he has said he was going to do. And I know, I have faith. No, not the wishful thinking, not the pie in the sky, not the Tupperware in the back of the refrigerator kind of faith. But I know God will keep his promise. I know there's something more coming. I know that God is faithful to his word. And verse 12, moving on to verse 13, Verse 13, the Hebrew writer says, all of these died in faith without receiving the promises. This is pretty incredible, isn't it? I mean, all of these, they died in faith. They died knowing. They died trusting. They died obeying and being committed. Not perfect. We know them. We've read their story. They're not perfect. But they were faithful. And they died, but they didn't actually see the promises. But having seen them and having welcomed them from a distance and having confessed that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. Verse 14, for those who say such things make it clear that they are seeking a country of their own. And indeed, if they had been thinking of that country from which they had went out, they would have had opportunity to return. In other words, if the country they were looking forward to was the one they just came from, then, you know, that's what they wanted. They could have easily gone back to that. They could have just returned to that. But as it is, they desire a better country. In other words, God is saying, I have something better for you than what you have right now. I have something better for you. Now, in reality, they didn't see it in fulfillment because it was still a promise that was waiting to be kept by God. In fact, we're still a part of that. But the reality is that they lived as if it were true, right? They lived their whole life by faith, knowing that God would ultimately keep his promise. Even if death happened, which it did, that wasn't going to stop God from keeping his promise. Death is not going to keep God from keeping his promise. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. Look at verse 17. He says, by faith, Abraham, when he was tested, he offered up Isaac, that's that son of promise, and he who had received the promises was offering up his only begotten son. It was he whom it was said, in Isaac your descendants shall be called. He considered that God is able to raise people even from the dead, from which he also received him back as a type. That's pretty powerful, right? I mean, up to this point, Abraham has done everything God has asked him to do. He finds himself in a situation where God has finally, in his old age, in Sarah's old age, given them a child of promise. And Abraham sees this, and of course it's an incredible thing. And he honors God, he glorifies God for this gift of a child. God is keeping his promise. And then God turns around and says, okay, now I want you to take that child up that mountain. I want you to sacrifice him to me. It's crazy thinking, isn't it? I mean, just trying to wrap your head around that concept. But the reality is, God would keep his promise regardless. And Abraham does, you know, and that's even more incredible. If you think about it, his faith was such that even when God asked him to do an incredible thing, now God's not going to ask you to do that, you know, in that light. I mean, he may ask us to do other things that are challenging and difficult. But this was a situation in which God asked this one person who was given an incredible promise that his seed, his descendants would be a blessing to all nations, that God had promised. He had brought this child into the world despite all the difficulties, despite the impossibility. And this child is the one that God says, okay, you give him to me in sacrifice. Now, he doesn't make him sacrifice his son. He stops him before he does and provides another sacrifice. Of course, that all foreshadows the reality that will come. That is God giving his son willingly on the cross to die for the sins of the world. And by the way, the promise of Abraham ultimately is Jesus. That is the promised son. He is the seed. He is the descendant. He is the one that God had in mind all along through this whole story, that eventually a son would come, eventually the seed of Abraham would come, and it would be Jesus, and God would be the one handing him over and allowing him to die on the cross. But just like Abraham and his knowledge of God, his understanding of who God is, Abraham thought, well, I don't know what God's going to do. Maybe he's going to raise Isaac back from the dead once I give him in sacrifice. I don't know. Whatever it is, I trust that God will keep his promise however he does it. Ultimately, what does he do with his very son that is given on the cross? He brings him up from the dead. God can raise people from the dead. And so both Abraham and Noah, they're really the same story, but they have the same lesson, don't they? They heard God, they trusted God, and they obeyed God. Seemingly simple, but it's worth remembering. To hear God, to trust God, and to obey God, no matter what. No matter what the circumstances may be, no matter what other people are telling you or what kind of information you receive from somebody else, you know, because that's going to happen too. You know, I mean, I remember being in college. I remember having a lot of information brought to me that I had never heard before. And it was challenging. And there were certainly some things in my faith that were challenging. There were people who were knowledgeable. There were people who, you know, I mean, they were in places of authority. And they were telling me things as a college student that I did not hear in Bible class. Okay? And I thought, I don't know who to believe. And there were some moments when me personally, I had to look at myself and say, who am I going to believe? Who am I going to trust? Who am I going to obey? Do I obey the words and the knowledge of somebody that I'm listening to and being educated by because they're feeding me information about the world that doesn't line up with the way the Bible is? Is that where I'm going to stand? Am I going to stand by the wisdom of man, by the wisdom of this world in regards to matters of life and matters of the way the world exists and where it came from and those kinds of things? Do I rely on that? Because sometimes it can sound pretty persuasive. Or do I rely on the words of God? The very words, by the way, that created everything that you see. Do I rely on his wisdom? Do I rely on his knowledge? Do I put my trust and faith in him? Do I hear him? Do I obey him? Do I trust him? Those are the things that we're going to be challenged with. And that's our story. Right? I mean, that's the way it is. I know when we're together, when you're home and you're with your parents and you adopt your parents' ways of thinking and you have this view of the world that is just, it's just here. It's been your life. It's been the way you've lived your whole life and you don't know anything else. And then suddenly you get to go out, outside your parents' home into a different world. And it can be intimidating, can be challenging. But all in all, we have to be willing to accept the fact that God is, that He exists, that God is a rewarder of those who seek Him. That God's desire, that our faith is founded on the words and the promises of God, not on anybody else. That we are to hear God, trust God, obey God. Those need to be primary. Will you go and learn a bunch of new stuff? Yeah, I hope you do. There's a lot of great stuff to learn out there. There's a whole new world to be explored, a whole new way of living, but the reality is, there are times in our life we have to be like Noah. We have to be like Noah and we have to realize that despite the fact that people might think we're crazy, for building a boat in our backyard, that the fact that people might think we're crazy for listening to the words of God, the fact that people might think we're crazy for being Christians, that ultimately someday judgment will come. And none of that difficulty, none of that challenge, none of that persecution, none of that will matter on a day when we are with our family safely on the ark. That's all that's going to matter. That's all that's going to matter. If we sought God, if we seek God, if we hear Him, if we trust Him, if we obey Him, that that's what God wants. If we maintain our faith, someday, the promise of God is that none of that, the difficulties of life, is going to matter because we will be with God. And that will matter more than anything. If there's anybody here this morning, maybe you've had some struggles in life and you need some prayers from this congregation. For those who are graduating, believe me, we're praying for you. We're praying for you. Maybe you have not put on Jesus in baptism, and that's a desire that you would like to visit with us about this morning. We're more than willing to talk to you. Whatever your needs might be, please come forward as we stand and sing.